lost the days of the oral communications. Joel isn't here yet because he is trying to move into that other state, which is in the state of touch and music. But he will come as soon as possible, and he will try to be here when he is here. There are two changes in the program. We would like to make a short break of about 20 minutes at noon and organize the last session at 12:30 until about 2 o'clock. And I hope that it's not causing problems for you here on the lunch arrangement, but the lunch will be later at 2 o'clock. The last session will be a special session in where Sally, Joe, and I will come, or we are trying to come up with questions. It might be also a statement that we're still trying to come up with questions, and we'd like answers. Now, this has happened before, but we'll see what comes out of that. We haven't seen each other's questions yet. If you want to. I was just excusing you. So then at about 4:30, we were invited back here for the opening of the exhibition. We did the speeches that might be contain complete new material for you, but there will also be other people coming in. And so it's just a short little ceremony, and after that will be a tour through the exhibition. And then tonight there will be a first concert. And as you know, there will be two more days of concerts, and Saturday it will be open. Some of us will be more available after we have done our concerts, and you're welcome to contact us personally and for questions about STEM in the future. But we will talk about STEM at the end of the session, between 12:30 and 2. Well, it's a great pleasure and honor to introduce Trevor. Trevor, we were sometimes even speaking, he's the only real composer amongst us, which is something to be taken not too seriously, but he is a serious man. But with the remarks he made, it would be easy to think that he is a bodiless person, as a reminded us. I don't know him that way. And he definitely, in the electroacoustic scene, is not the most bodiless person, for sure.
Well, he gave himself away. He said he was into being bodiless.
I will be able to respond this notion. Trevor, may we invite you right now? Welcome.
Thank you very much. I'm learning here. I was slightly puzzled when I was invited to this convention. What the hell have I got to say about touch? So I've been listening to what people have been saying, taking it in, and I more or less made up what I'm going to say last night. And I thought it might be nice to begin with some actual touching, some physical touching. First of all, let me say that I have quite a range of activities as a musician. One extreme, I take recorded sounds, write computer programs, dissect them, transform them, and make pieces that exist on a tape at home. Probably you think about the farthest you can get from concepts of touch. At the other end, for economic reasons, being a freelance composer in Britain is not an easy life. And about the only way you can earn money in Britain is to do some kind of social good with your art. So if you go out and educate people about art, or you run community workshops about art, you can get paid. But if you want to do art, forget it. So, in fact, I'm very much in favour, I wasn't cynical about this, I'm very much in favour of taking the arts out to people and trying to get in contact with new audiences, particularly with young people who haven't built up all those prejudices about what is art, what is music and what isn't music, or what is art and what isn't art. And I developed various workshop techniques for teaching musical skills and for working with people in general. And I thought it would be nice to begin with a couple of these little workshops. Because they illustrate some concepts. So I want to start with physical touch, and what I'd like to do is to volunteer this lot of people to come up to the front here and stand up. These are bestsellers in Japan. The reason I get invited to Japan is not to do electric easy games. This is a very simple game, but it's a variation of a game that exists in virtually all cultures around the world. So I'd like the front part of you to stand in a circle close together and then turn around. Face upwards. And I'm going to put you a little bit further that way. Now, I'd like the other five of you to stand on the outside facing those people. Just choose someone and place them. Raise both hands. Okay. Now, the people on the outside, I'd like you to move along by one hand to your right. So, like so. Okay, excellent. Now, with this arrangement, you'll find that your left hand is touching the left hand of the person opposite you, and your right hand, the right hand of the person opposite you. And we now play a version of the game, which in England is called patacate. This is known in Japan. It's known. I have never been anywhere where people don't know this game. Okay, and you can do this with any kind. We'll do something not entirely simple, but fairly simple. So this will be both, keep both hands together. Okay? Knee. Left. Right. Together. Okay. Very slowly. Bow. Knee. Left. Try not to say the words. Try just to do I'll have this group from this side over here. What we've just been doing is a game which uses physical touch and rhythm to teach something about musical timing. And it relates immediately to what we're doing with some of our touch. So, in the next game, I'd like to illustrate something slightly more metaphorical, which is what I call structural touching. And this is a fundamental thing in music as far as I'm concerned. Now, I think we're a little bit out of numbers, so I was going to use the phrase the phenomenology of touch. It's not sure if that's a little bit too difficult to say. So, if you find the phenomenology of touch a difficult thing to say, you can use the divisibility of time for this exercise, whichever you would find better. what I'd like is, being on this side, to repeat this pattern. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. On this side, I'd like you to repeat this pattern. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. Okay, and of course the trick is that I need to do it together. So I'll set you going. You need to be loud because when they come in, they're going to put you off. And then I'll introduce them. You just keep going. So. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch. The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology
of touch.
The phenomenology
of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
The phenomenology of touch.
Let's take the people to the back now. If you'd like to sit down, half of you at this side, half of you at this side. The interesting thing about this game, which is a polyrhythmic game, essentially you're using the same sound material, but they're divided. One group is singing in a pattern of six beats, and the other pattern of eight beats. And these cross each other, and at certain points they coincide. If you like, they touch structure. So as you're performing, you're aware that somehow two things are completely different. And suddenly they're doing the same thing as you, so that goes away. And that sort of touching is a result of the structure. It's a very simple structure in this case. But it illustrates to me a general point about music. An interesting difference between music, if you like, and conversation is the sort of rule in conversation is that you speak, then I speak, then you speak, then I speak, though it doesn't always work like that. But in music, one of the things is we can all speak at the same time, and somehow it works. And this is to do with this idea of structural touching. Somehow, some things will touch each other structurally in music. The best example is harmony, for example. We depending on which rules you follow, people tend to agree in a particular culture that certain sounds will go together, or they won't go together, or if they don't go together, then they must come together, and so on. And so we get this kind of complicated touching, which I call generally counterpoint, which is the basis of one important thing in musical thinking. Let's just do one more of these, see if we can manage it. It's slightly more difficult, only marginally difficult. The problem with this is there's no place to breathe for you, but you want to. So this is the same game again, slightly different rooms. So the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch. Okay, that's all you're going to do this. The phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch. Very good, okay? So let's rock. Don't forget to breathe. And as loud as you can. The phenomenology the phenomenology of touch, the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch,
the phenomenology of touch.
Okay, that's fine. You're able to touch at the end, though. Okay, thanks very much. So this is 5 against 7, so that the pattern repeats after 35 units. That's a kind of metaphorical concept of the idea of touching. The third notion of touching is what I call the empathetic notion. I'm very interested in working with a human voice, and rather than musical instruments, or shall we say other musical instruments, there are many reasons. The two most fundamental ones are the voice itself is the most flexible sound source we have available to us. One can make all kinds of sounds, which I'll demonstrate shortly, of different kinds, and you can also move very smoothly and easily between them. We're in touch with our voices in a very intimate way, so much so that we're not really aware of it. Obviously, when we speak, we're using lots and lots of muscle formations and so on, that allow us to form the shape of our mouths and so on in very subtle ways. For example, no matter how hard I did, I try to say, Achtergrach. You know I'm not Dutch. Anyone who's probably North America will realize I'm not from North America. Anyone from London here will know I'm not from London. And in fact, anybody from Manchester here will know I'm not from Manchester, even though I live only 80 miles from Manchester. And for me, I know I'm from Leeds, and I can tell someone is from Huddersfield, which is only 15 miles away. And how do I tell that? Because it's to do with vowel tuning. Very specifically, in the English language at least, the typical difference between North American English and North of England English is that North American English has lots of diphthongs. Yeah, this kind of sound. And Northern England English has lots of non-diphthongs. We tend to talk like this, okay? Very flat vowels, very off Japanese, in fact. But these things are very finely tuned, so very subtle differences. We always get them right for ourselves. If I say ah, I say it in a particular way which speakers in my group recognize immediately, but that involves a particular formation of the mouth. I mean, it's ever so slightly different. You get a very slightly different sound, and people recognize he's not from around here, or whatever. So the other thing about this intimacy is you don't usually think about it, but the voice is so intimately connected with our thought processes, that it's almost as if speaking were an extension of our mind. We don't think that some process sets off here, articulates some muscles, and then makes a sound. It's as if the making of the sound were part of the process itself. Now, the second thing about the voice is that it has these other links outside the musical. It relates clearly to. You can tell whether I'm male or female, you can tell whether I'm ill or not ill, you can probably tell whether I'm large-chested or small-chested, you can probably tell whether I'm honest or dishonest, all kinds of things, except I'm a conman, an interesting use of the voice to suggest that I'm very trustworthy or I'm not. There are all kinds of very subtle clues we can pick up from the voice. And when working with this material, plug in, if you like, and touch these connections with other people, with social conventions. Another level, for example, we're all primates, and primates laugh and, not cry so much, but something like they scream, they laugh, and they do something like crying. So we recognize these things universally across all cultures, and all these things to do with the articulations of the voice. So, in a sense, I'm able to communicate very directly with my voice through a process of empathy. When you hear sounds that I make, you can imagine or even physically realize making them, and you tend to associate meanings or situations or intentions to communicate or intentions not to communicate or whatever when I do them, even when I do these things in a fairly abstract context. So what I'll do next is I do a little bit of vocal improvisation, where I play with my voice. I can train myself to separate all these things out. And we'll see this kind of touching work. These kind of solo touching work. Implies mental states, even if they don't actually have them. I'm just able to, I've trained myself to be able to make those kind of sounds. But normally, we react, in a sense, to an interpretation of those sounds. And so with the voice, I'm able to touch people very directly, even as a solo performer, because my usual statement is if someone plays a multiphonic on a clarinet, lots of clarinetists in the audience are interested. But if someone sings a multiphonic, everybody in the audience is interested. They're intrigued. They want to know what's happening. They may be worried. So this is the next way of touching things. Now, the fourth way of touching things is to touch the materials. Now, obviously, when we're performing, particularly with a voice, we're touching the materials in this very very direct way, where we don't even have this sense of separation. It's not an arm's length thing, touch. It's so intimate that we're not aware of that touch. But it's possible to put the voice at arm's length and to touch it in a special way with technology. So the next area I like to work in is to record my voice and then take it apart, if you like, put it on the operating table of the computer. And I write programs that allow me to chop the voice about and do things which you cannot do in live performance. Two simple examples. If you take the sound, or I've just done it. I take the sound, where I've got a rising thing and it's divided into grade. And I can do that backwards. But what happens if I wanted to go at that speed? Well, it's physiologically impossible. I can't actually move the pictures as fast as I can make the sound. But on the computer, I can do that. I can say to the computer, look for those grains, separate them out, each little one, and then reorganize them at random, or whatever. So I can make the voice do these impossible things. In fact, there are various levels at which the computer can reorganize material. One of them is the level at which we might articulate things as events. So I'd say, let's imagine a drummer is easier to demonstrate hitting things and therefore triggering sounds. We can reorganize things at that level. That tends to be what happens, say, with MIDI-based triggering systems. Then we can reorganize things at the grain level, which is this. You can hear the individual things, but they're so short that they're not rhythmic. You can tell whether they're faster or slower, whether they're regular or irregular. In fact, you can tell whether they're utterly regular or almost utterly regular. This is almost utterly regular, but if it were regular, you'd notice. With the computer, I can reorganize things at that level. But the interesting thing also is it's a level below that. The difference between R and S, ultimately, is to do with what happens to the sound in time. In a very short time frame, something which we can't access directly, physically with our bodies, but we can certainly access with the computer. So I can turn one sound into another. I can turn my voice into the sound of a bell or anything I like. And So I enjoy this, and it's interesting that a musician can become like a sculptor. We talked earlier about the idea of the sculptor having this kind of relationship with the material, where you have an idea to realise, but then there's the resistance of the material. One has the same thing here. Although there are general principles about taking sounds apart and reconstructing them, until you get the particular sound you've recorded, you don't know what will happen. And often I'll pursue some strategy with my software, and which I think, oh, this would be great, it worked last time, and it's really boring. And some other thing happens by accident, and it's fantastic, and I use it. So there's all this interplay between the material of the voice, which has become physical, because we can now record it. It's like having actual sound there, like an object. And to illustrate this, first of all, I'd like to play a tiny fragment of sound. This is from the piece Tongues of Fire. And it begins with this tiny fragment of sound, which lasts about 1 second, and then make a 25-minute piece out of this fragment of sound. So we just hear the fragment of sound. I'll tell you when to stop. That's on the CD. That's it. Here it is again. Okay, stop. So if you wind that up. Okay, so this entire 25 minutes is made from that vocal gesture. And so using the computer, it's possible to take such an element and reconstruct it and shape it and bend it and transform it into completely different materials. And I like that idea of transformation. That's a continuation of something that's very traditional in music, which is taking materials and transforming them. And now with the computer, we can actually take sound as material. And probably while that's winding forward, give me a big talk. So if you want to know about this, then you can read the book. I'm doing this because I have to wind the tape forward. But I finally wrote down in the new book, Audible Design, many of the ways that one can approach transforming sound, the sort of things that you have to take into account. for example, this business about the time frame. Is it the time frame of events? Is it the time frame of grains? Is it the time frame of sonority itself? Or is it the time frame of form? If we have two events that last a minute, we can probably say with some certainty that they're roughly the same length, but we certainly can't say they're exactly the same length or nowhere near. If we have two events lasting a second, particularly if we have four events each lasting a second, we can say with a fair degree of accuracy that these are like 95% equal, because we have some kind of physiological measure, I guess, and now I'm speculating, but something to do with our biological clocks or the fact that we have certain bodily processes which run at these rates, allow us to measure these things. We don't have to go there going, ah, we know it's, yeah, that's regular. That's not regular, and I don't have to be able to count it to tell that. At the level of the grain, well, we know it's, the second one is faster than the first one, but we don't like to say how much faster, because it's outside that range of physiological relation. And down the level of and whoop, there's no way we can relate those things together. They just sound different. They have this different quality. Okay, so I'm just going to play an arbitrary bit from this piece. It's difficult to select anything in particular, but this is the sort of things you can do if you actually get hold of inside the materials, all made from the little bit you've heard. Inside the materials, like a sculpture and working them, molding them. And now the final way of touching is the most distant. This is doing somebody else's voice. I'm playing this because I think it's rather fun, but I was commissioned to do a piece for a concert in Berlin. And I decided to work on the voices of various political or well-known figures and transform them in various ways. And the principal protagonists in this piece are Margaret Thatcher, bless her soul, and Princess Diana, bless her soul. And there are four pieces. Two of them use Diana's voice. One of them uses Margaret Thatcher's voice. One of them uses the voice of Ian Paisley, If you don't know who Ian Paisley is, well, you're lucky. You're a very powerful sort of evangelist preacher, extreme Protestant who protests in the European Parliament about the existence of Catholicism. He's very vocal in opposing the unification of Ireland. But in this particular speech, you may be more sympathetic to him because he's actually sending Margaret Thatcher to the devil. The devil sending the devil to the devil is quite an interesting idea. So what I've done here is I've taken the speech and I've used various ways to modify the voice, not very much, to comment upon it. This is what I call touching up. The problem with touching up is a double entendre in English. To touch up a painting is to kind of improve something that's damaged, but it also has rather unpleasant sexual connotations as well. But that's not what I intend here. I'm trying to bring out the quality of thought, if any, behind this kind of speaking. By the way, I've treated it. There's some obvious things, like the use of cartoon-like voices by shifting the pitch of the voice, but almost more subtle things like certain words have been stretched or impossible sounds of vibrato have been added to them, which are not possible to produce vocally. You may disagree. My feeling is I'm trying to enhance the over-the-topness of this kind of performance. So this is the doubt.
Oh, God!
Very
five different ways of time-shifting and time-stretching. They all tend to have a certain quality.
That's something, that's sound.
Yes. I guess it's theoretically possible. It's possible to do without the being change. You could build a model, if you like, and analyze the thing, build a computer physical model.
Right.
And re-synthesize it. It's very difficult to get to have exactly the same. That for myself, that doesn't worry me too much, because I'm interested in the result. I'm only interested in the result. I'm not interested in the idea that it's meant to be the original model. I'm interested in what it actually says.
Yeah.
And I'll choose a different sort of pitch shifting or time stretching technique depending on what kind of result I want. There's some very peculiar time stretching things in this piece which give crazy artifacts which no physicist or professional human person would dream of ever using. But I'm interested in the artifacts. You know, it's crazy sounds that you get out of this.
Are there any historical documents on the intention in the development of the sound instruments, which is written in the voice of the theater, or the use of the voice? That at the point in which these were being evolving or developing, were things written down about the intention of the, or whether things succeeded or not?
I do my research by listening, and I sort of go to sources for myself, so I know about it. And I listen and try to figure out physically how to make those sounds. But also the ethos in which the sounds are made as well, and in a very slow context. So I don't use them very fast and changing. So that takes them out of context. But they probably are. I'm like an engineer. How do you do these things?
Yeah, I think I'm here. Imagine a 15th century Japanese
equipment
like you.
Oh, I got it.
How much?
Well,
there's certainly our cultures in which sound serves a purpose other than change from the middle of the default to the scene as a method for achieving this particular form of communication. But I think it's Tim Robbins reminded us an awful lot of what we do is from this piece of shots to the humble kind of side of culture rather than the explaining what we're doing inside of culture. You can do it kind of
the work because of the piece of
it. Yeah.
Well, I think there are interesting two things involved. You know, there's a performing these things up to a point, I know technically what I'm doing because I've thrown myself out to do all these things. But we talked about this yesterday, you forget the point which I call second nature, where you forget about how to do it, and you're just able to do it, and it comes as naturally as speaking. There's another problem that you don't have to transfer over meaning, so you have this curious spread of meanings and suggestions and historic precedents, which is, it depends what you want to communicate, and if I want to communicate to you directly like I'm writing you now, then I have to be specific and I speak in a language of those concerns. In the musical context, I'm not doing exactly that. So it's interesting to have all these shamanistic or associated or whatever you like to call things going on. And that's what's exciting to do about music. And of course, you can focus in, you can move from being, as I'm doing reflection, from being directly discursive to being sort of whatever this is.
There's an interesting dialectic between, let's say, this kind of interest or disinterest in synthetic or artifact or electronic aspect of sound and use to natural sound. It's like yourself on the track to using natural sound but using electronic means to transform it or something like that. And the reason I did it was because I didn't like the simplicity of electronic synthesis. I didn't like FM sound, I didn't like it. I was taking it And so I want to find a way to use natural sound, but could be used in a completely different way. So I was trying to achieve something that was, but I wanted to have more complexity and move to something. So it's a strange thing.
It's not my link interested in this. That's the other way.
You're talking about touching your own voice. What's for you the difference in working with your own voice in peace or working with these other people's voice?
Okay, well, the swing with your own voice, working with other people's voice is by telling them what to do, or giving them instructions or planning the score, and working with someone else's voice by just recording them. So I would only tend to to manipulate someone's voice directly. So I'd either ask them, or there have to be some good political reasons to do it, because it's a bit of an unfriendly thing to do. When working with performers, there's an interesting set of constraints, because when I'm actually performing myself, things happen either in terms of how fast they happen, or even in terms of energy. I remember once improvising with a saxophonist, and I was producing these sounds so much louder than the and normally I can't hear it at all. This was about a month ago. But I couldn't do that again afterwards. So things happen out of the energy of the performance and the thing. But when you have performance, you have to be able to say, I want to make this sound there. Well, not necessarily. Let's say it's a piece of story in which events follow each other and you have to do this and that. I can go, but I can't say, okay, I want you to do that at 35 seconds after singing a lot of the class. You can ask. It's A, uncard, and B, probably impossible. So there's a different, something different for yourself. I mean, in general, a very simple thing is improvised music can tend to be more fast and more articulate than composing, because you can articulate things directly, very quickly, and very suddenly. But you can't ask people to articulate. Not usually. So there tends to be a set of things you can do, and a set of things you can do together when you give a score to people, which is smaller than the set of things you can actually do when you do this.
You were speaking about the operation room or operation table, you dissect or reconstruct the voting sample. I can imagine that the place you have a different knife, with your own voice, is that the kind of emotional relationship with your can you treat your own voice as a political voice?
No, that's interesting what you're saying. No, I tend to treat my own voice as just a source. Something that I know it's to other people, it's me. To me, it's just a source of sonority. When I'm working with a network, when I'm working I'm aware of their personality, their public personality, and therefore I'm trying to interact with them in some way to draw it out and comment on it. I need to work in that way, but in another sense, it would be pointless to use their voice in particular, unless I'm able to do
that. Sometimes tend to have voices of people that I really like somewhere stored in my memory, and that during a piece when things go wrong or something, I can call them up to cheer me up. Is this animism? But I can't imagine that your own voice can just be treated as source.
Yes,
yeah.
It's this thing about mathematics, I suppose. I'm interested in putting things into distance and analysing them and saying, what's the structure? What happens to me? Time structure, which doesn't really relate to me. I suppose if I think that's more. The longer the event is, the more it's something of me. But when you get down to the time schedule, it becomes irrelevant. But it's nice having all these different levels that you can work in a very abstract. You've got this fascinating sound from a technical point of view to
you said it was, well, I like to use it at the beginning of the talk, it was great. I mean, Lava is great, but it's great, there's tons of fire, that was a piece of good work, right?
Yeah.
It was a little bit. When you started out, you talked about voices as being really kind of situated, as being really a marker of geography, history, all these kinds of things were connected with the individual voice, which I thought was very interesting. And so I so I wanted to follow up on this historical aspect that you brought up as well, because it seems to me that particularly in the 1920s, you get these kind of two versions of scat singing that occur. You get the Swiss scatters, led by Schmidt, etc., and you get Louis Armstrong and his descendants. And I'm just wondering, you start very different notions again of history and identity, and also in terms of really even different notions of how you use the voice and the idea of an improvised way of doing this. And I can imagine both groups of people at this time really investigating things along the lines of illustrated today. So what I wanted to ask you was how you trace your own situatedness in history with regard to this work, and not necessarily with regard to where you come from, this town, or maybe let's look at the relationship there too. But where do you locate yourself in this kind of history or this kind of what you do?
I think the simple answer to that is I don't. My view would be that I'm located in history as a matter of fact. And when people are telling my life afterwards, you know, they'll say, oh, so this guy was located in history here. But it's not something that has to be consciously of concern to me. I just go around looking at things, and I'm probably am prejudiced towards something rather than others. But my view of myself is that I'm not prejudiced. I'll go and look at Japanese things, I'll go and look at American things, I'll look at Latin American things, because I'm interested in how people use the North. Some things tend to be easier to do than others, because unless you're brought up in Japanese culture to do that unwrapping globalization, unless you've done it all your life, to do it really well is virtually impossible. But to do it is possible. So I tend to pick things up as technical things. How do you sing half semi? How do you sing grapple balls? How do you sing aggressively, whatever it is? I'm not interested in the historical situation. I know that may be something to do with being English.
The claim is that in your speaking voice, you're situated, but in your performative voice, you're not.
What I'm saying is I'm not consciously situated. What I'm saying is I might be, and if you'd like to throw some light on that, I don't have any problems about it, but I don't think about things like that. Like when I speak, I don't think, oh God, I've got a Yorkshire accent, or people will know I'm from England, you know. It occurs to me, well, God, it's embarrassing, I can't speak Dutch. I can only speak English. So that's something different.
I'm interested in the sources and the sources you've used. The last year I had an interesting experience with Mongolian undertow singing, and also the didgeridoo, which I use very much in the world. And have you used these, and if you have used them, like for example that moment in the series of reading that thing with the ditch, how do you can use that within knowing where it's going to go?
One thing you can't do with the voice alone is the circular breathing. You need an extension up here to generate the sound while you're doing the breathing. But certainly, singing at harmonics is probably where I started, because I suppose the short historical answer in that to George is that it started with when I heard Stim singing at harmonics, and then someone almost the same time played these two harmonics, and I discovered I could do these, and so I became interested in the voice, and I just began to explore it. Make funny noises in the back, but catalogue. I have this kind of alien personality, like index cards.
I was just going to make a random map, because you do that. talk about emotional contents when you're doing your vocal investigations. And I'm wondering if you worry about losing that to some extent when you're doing these computer transformations. It seems as the more radically you transform the sound of the voice, and the more actually physically impossible it would be for those sounds to be made by an actual person, that you tend, I mean, you may be gaining something else, but it seems like you're to some extent can lose that kind of emotion.
Well, I mean, that's very interesting what you're trying to do. In a sense, what I'm doing here appears very emotional. In fact, it's not emotional at all. In fact, in some ways, it's very technical. I mean, I can laugh hideously or pleasantly like that because I've told myself to do it. And it doesn't actually display any emotions that I actually have. Well, that's the very, I have a tiny twitch of those emotions, maybe work. You already get the false illusion when you're in voice, like you hear an actor pretending to die. Well, they're not dying, you believe they're dying. I don't have a problem, therefore, with hearing these things on recording. If you hear, if you hear Ian Paisley, recording Ian Paisley, which has that power. It's not the same as being there, but it certainly has that power because it carries this intense conviction, this incredible prejudice in the voice. I suppose what you're also saying is once the sounds become less recognizable as vocal, then you lose it. But as you say, you gain something else. If the voice becomes the sound of the bees or the sound of the crowd or whatever, this kind of has some kind of symbolic resonance. Or if it's used in a particular way, there are all kinds of things you can do. In the previous piece I wrote, which is about cities, you hear these traffic sirens. And only about 15 minutes into the piece do you realize that this is the voice of anyone. And when you first hear it, it's been so transformed, it sounds like a traffic siren. And right there, to remove the transformation, you hear this. So you can play with those kind of things which are not possible. They're different kinds of emotions, they deal with different issues. What I'm saying is it's just different. It's not one is better or one is worse.
The version of the body that is using itself, taking itself as instrument. And I'm hoping we can come back to this in the discussion. And then Bianca and others are very concerned with this issue. Because Roman will be moving over to an art that is often simplistically dismissed as being highly instrumentalized, and the subtleties of the relationship between body and object, or to be one's own body as object, in public can be often forgotten. So Rome's going to be able to put us out into one of these subtleties.
Yeah, actually, the first explicit public reference I heard in the past 2 days was the mention from Raku a few minutes ago, which, and it's very interesting that we do talk about the vocal as actually the puppet theater, because it is, I mean, while most Western puppet theater doesn't actually use the voice in the same way that the Asian traditions do, we do voices, we do puppet voices, which become very much part of the character. So not so much like moving on. I had a very interesting insight about an hour ago when Deborah first began his talk. I realized the puppeteers are basically shy people. So if I didn't volunteer for the one of those games, I've been thinking a lot about the relationship. I mean, 3 days ago when I first arrived, I was very unsure about how I should fit into all of this. And by the end of the day yesterday, I was saying to myself, it was all and a lot of the issues that seemed to be coming up were things that puppeteers were talking about 100 years ago. And so I thought I might, talk about that a little bit. I am myself, I mean, first of all, for you to understand what it means to be a puppeteer, I call myself a puppeteer, and I think about it every time I cross an international border where I have to write down the profession. And it's a good one because border guards don't really have to know what it means, especially if you write it in English. So I was challenged once in England. Said, well, you know, I should do it. And the border guard said, well, Punch and Judy isn't really a puppet show. It's more of a seaside entertainment. what it means for me, I mean, in practical terms, is that I do make my own puppets, and I do perform them. I also, as an extension of that activity that I've been involved in for many years now, I do also design and direct larger productions, which means, of course, collaborating with larger groups of people. But the process is still very much the same. And, of course, the idea of making a puppet to accomplish play a specific role or accomplish a specific task is very, very close, I think, to a lot of what we've been talking about in the past couple of days. It's also very, very integral to the whole tradition of puppet theater and has become even more important probably in the 20th century than it ever has before, in that each puppet performer or company has a style that is dictated by the nature, the look, the movement possibilities and so forth of the puppets that they use. There are no such things as puppet factories. There practically are no puppet makers anymore. In countries where there are so-called traditions, Indonesia and so forth, there has been a division of labor over the centuries into those who make puppets and those who perform with them, which is something that was attempted in the ex-East Bloc countries during a number of decades, where there was huge state support for the art of puppetry, and they had workshops where puppets were produced, and the performers were mainly actors who performed with the figures. But that's already some, at some remove, a situation that's some removed from what we like to think of as being the essence of puppet theater, which has become more and more important to practitioners of puppetry in the past few decades because of the challenge in various other media, the need to define what puppetry is. Is there such a thing as contemporary puppetry, or is it just a kind of, you know, low-tech form or unevolved form of some other kind of theater or film? So anyway, the issue, though, of making the puppet, and I'll just say this quickly because it's something that people keep coming back to. There is, I mean, we talk a lot also about the resistance in the material. What's true of puppet theater, and I think in many ways typifies all of that issue that we've been discussing, is that in a puppet performance, the essence of the performance really is about the interaction, the tension, the conflict, if you like, between the performer and the object that he's manipulating, whether that object is figurative or very abstract, or, as in many contemporary shows, just an object. In some, to carry that even farther, a hand puppet, when puppetry was responding to the naked actor on the empty stage movement in theater, puppeteers were doing hand puppets as the puppet example of that tendency. So what that really means is that it's not about the gesture that's produced. That's a secondary interest. The getting a puppet to wave goodbye in a very old-fashioned sense is less significant to the art form than the effort involved in making that happen. Which means that there are really two kinds of puppet theater that we recognize now. And there's puppet theater that really focuses the audience's attention on that effort. It's like a three-way activity. There's the puppet that is acting. There is the performer that is getting it to accomplish whatever the task is. The gesture that's performed, and there has to be for puppet theater to be puppet theater in the pure sense, audience complicity with that. In other words, the means of the achievement of that gesture has to be recognized by the audience, even if it's not necessarily seen. So now this has become a very important point, given the fact that the word puppet is thrown around very, very loosely and very widely nowadays, particularly in Hollywood, where any kind of special effects dummy is called a puppet, and anyone who performs a special effects activity, like making, for example, the telephone receiver. I was actually called in on a Woody Allen film to advise them about getting the telephone receiver to lift off of the cradle and move in the air all by itself, which was for a film called Alice, in which the human being was supposedly invisible, and they were having a great deal of trouble getting this to happen. They had very elaborate robotic kind of thing, and the problem was that the telephone kept missing the cradle on the way back. I mean, just by a very, very fine mouth, but still, it made it look like the person who was doing it was a little bit gone. So we put a rod on. We said the low-tech solution. It was very simple. But the issue of a puppet being then a machine, an automaton, this is something that, as I said, Kirk mentioned earlier, goes back more than 100 years. The need for puppeteers, or the desire for puppeteers, for whatever reason we may now attribute, to assert the fact that a puppet is not an automaton, And that's a very interesting, it's interesting that that's such an important point, that has been consistently such an important point. Even at the in the early 19th century, for example, where the most sophisticated from a, and a realistically sophisticated puppets were string marionettes, which were intended, part of the, you know, the aesthetic response involved in watching string marionettes was to see how, just how lifelike they could be, just how much like human beings. Of course, this was happening at the same time that automata were being developed with incredible sophistication, and at roughly the same time that, that people began more openly talking about the human body as a machine. So, but there, in spite of puppetry's proximity to that, and the apparent visual relationship between a puppet and an automaton, puppet performers have been very insistent from that time to the present about the fact that it isn't. And I think that there, again, the emphasis is, yes, puppets can accomplish that. And in fact, puppetry coupled with contemporary media like film, for example, is, you know, it, aspects of puppetry, I should say, has become a very normal, it's become such a normal part of our daily lives that we now, you know, I think for that reason, puppetry is becoming a kind of accepted art form. Rarely do you turn on the television when you don't see some form of manipulation of images or three-dimensional animation, the use of prostheses and animated figures, and even in kind of normal films now has become very, very, very common. And of course, by extension, we now, in what New Yorkers are calling a, you know, post-humanist era, we now openly embrace the idea that the human being is a kind of machine or automaton. For centuries, puppet theater was held in fear a little bit and kept on the outside of society for very much for that reason. The fact that there was this feeling that it was in some way anti-human. Even through the 20th century, the biggest debate and dialogue in theater about puppetry has been this notion that the puppet is some kind of threat to the actor. And people, you know, go back to Gordon Craig, for example, who had developed his theory, the Uber Marionette, which some of you may or may not be familiar with, in which he posited, you know, he looked to a day when, you know, actors would be replaced by these so-called Uber Marionettes, and there's a lot of discussion about what that really means. But the idea that a puppet is in some way better than or can do things that an actor can, and even puppeteers have fallen into this trap. And you read I've heard as recently as a couple of months ago at a conference a critic on puppet theater saying, well, puppets can do this and they can do that and actors can't. Well, yes, it's true, puppets can fly, actors can't, but they don't do it all by themselves. And that's the really, as obvious as that sounds, that's the really fundamental aspect of puppet theater that is often overlooked. It's, I guess, again, a product of the illusion. So in the 20th century, in reaction to that idea that puppets are somehow autonomous, and also because puppeteers somewhat in the spirit of what Tim was saying yesterday, puppeteers were feeling a little, you know, a little neglected, a little hidden, as it were. Puppeteers began to emerge, and from what in the West had become the puppet proscenium, and show themselves on stage with their puppets. And suddenly, everything changed. And this has been a very, very recent phenomenon. With I myself performed at a festival of specifically puppet theater in Berkeley, California, where I was told the next day there was a really, really violent debate about whether I ought to have been visible or not, and whether that meant that it was not really a puppet show. And so there, this trend has carried through to the present. But as puppeteers began emerging from behind whatever it was that masked or hid them, they began also, when this happened for the first time, like in the 1950s and 60s in New York, and European, the puppeteers began talking about what their puppets as musical instruments. And that was a first kind of new trend in the attempt to define what a puppet was. And suddenly the whole language of the descriptive language that is often used for the performer, the musician with his musical instrument, began to be applied to puppetry. The result was that puppeteers began to be seen more like virtuoso. Their performances were more seen for the virtuosity of the performance. And what effectively happened is that people began looking less at the puppet and looking more at the performer. I remember seeing a stereotypical example of that, in which the performer strode out on stage and presented himself a moment and said, one man, two hands, 10 fingers, 1,000 marionettes, and began to and go into this, performance, which was very much about his dexterity and his ability to make puppets. So this was a fairly short-lived phenomenon. Although there are still very good examples of people doing that. Albrecht Dröser in Germany, for example, still performs in that vein and in the spirit of that time. In a reaction against that a little bit, or maybe a further evolution of this attempt to redefine what the puppet was, people began using, in Europe especially, because it doesn't quite work in English, people began talking about puppetry as figure theater, in an attempt to get away from the word puppet, because the word puppet or marionette in various European languages is a loaded term. It had so much baggage attached to it that puppeteers began looking, who were doing much more serious theater, began looking for alternatives to describe the puppet. And they came up with the term figure theater, which is also still very current. Which, as I said, doesn't quite work in English, but in Italian, French, German, it's still very, very, very current in Germany. The problem, of course, which this whole, it was an attempt to put the emphasis and the focus back on the puppet, but the puppet as a kind of art object or an object capable of artistic expression. But very soon after that term began to be used, there was a whole theoretical backlash against the idea of figurative and representational art. So, of course, the word figure had its problems. And the response to that was yet another attempt to redefine the puppet as an object in the purest sense. Younger companies began a movement called the Theater of Objects, which is basically coexisted in particularly the 1970s and early 80s with the growth of the performance art movement and the visual and what we call visual theater, for lack of a better term, in the United States, which of course includes people like Robert Wilson and so forth. So the theater of objects, then of course what this has led to is innumerable numbers of meetings and conferences and so forth in which people are talking about, what a puppet is. And we've gotten to a point after probably, 15 years now where people are beginning to say, I don't want to talk about it anymore. Because we go, there's no resolution. But the fact that there is the focus now in the world of puppet theory is on that most essential point. What is a puppet? What is the definition of it? When does something become a puppet? When is it not? My own approach has been to say that a puppet only exists in a virtual sense. That if any object is a puppet, it's a puppet event or can be a puppet is a puppet only when it's being used as a puppet, which means that when you put it back down again, it becomes glass once again. And of course, the difference between that and a puppet, like a sculpted, articulated figure like the kind you might buy in the street in Prague, is evident. And yet, the kind of puppet that you buy in the street in Prague is not any more of a puppet in this true, pure sense than the glass that you pick up and use as a puppet. So my theory has been to put the emphasis on that, to put the existence of the puppet in time, in motion, in use, so that it's a kind of kinetic virtuality or something. That's a dangerous term to use, then that of course raises or leads us to the issue. I'm going to finish quickly because I've got some questions. But is a puppet, is its ultimate goal then the illusion of life, or even the imitation of life? Even if we take a more what I like to call primitivist approach to puppetry, and we reject as secondary, not reject totally, but we view as secondary the illusionistic attempts of Hollywood and so forth, or even the German marionette theater to imitate life convincingly. It's still the magic of puppet theater, as it's often referred to, is often in those moments where the object is manipulated or handled in such a way that it conveys to the audience, or with the audience complicity, we believe it. We believe in it, or we give it credence, and we even will empathize with it in a conventional, traditional theatrical sense. And there is something very strange about that, and it's something even as a performer, I often think to myself when I go out on stage and I have these things there, and they're things, and I know they're things, and even if I have my own superstitious tendencies, I feel the audience responding, I get absorbed in it, and that potential for absorption, identification, whatever you want to call it, is curious, and is obviously fundamental to human nature, or a puppet theater would not have survived through all of the centuries that it has. And we wouldn't be doing it. I'm still not quite sure I know why I am doing this. But so what that means is that the illusion of life is not really what it's about. That is kind of a byproduct of it. What it's really about is the indication of the potential for infusing life into something that has none. And that in itself is such a stimulus.